Thank you, sir. Thank you for very kind words. And at the outset, I would like to thank our dear friend Dr. Alok for involving me in this prestigious meeting. And I am really, surprised and pleased to see that we have a very different format of this meeting. It is not that standard talks and debates and discussions that we have been doing. You know, it's a fantastic format, much more interactive and much more informal. Still, very educative. So my compliments to Dr. Alok for setting up this wonderful platform. I would also, invite Dr. Dayanidhi to, join me and say his opening remarks and start with the panel discussion.
Professor Mehr?
Dayanidhi, you are muted. Yeah, it's fine. Yeah.
A very good afternoon, everybody. And I'm really feel honored to be a part of this panel discussion. And without wasting much time, would like to proceed further. And I would request Dr. Makkar sir to start this panel
session. Dayanidhi sir, it's just a request you to increase your device volume.
Sound volume. Can you increase it a little bit, Dayanidhi?
Yeah, is it okay, sir?
Yeah.
Is it okay now?
Okay.
Sir, now it is better. Bridge, you can start.
Yes, sir. So I think, at the outset, what I would like to say is that we had a wonderful quick presentations by Dr. Sambet and Dr. Sahu, and then very interesting panel discussion, which was, run by Dr. Rakesh Sai. So I think a lot has been covered, but still for the sake of some, there'll be some repetitions here, but I think that will be helpful for some people who may have joined a little late. But a lot of things have been touched, but still there'll be queries which we'll try to, explore during this panel discussion. So Arvind, you have been listening to all this, and I don't think there is a doubt that diabetes and cancer have a very strong association. So, important thing is, just for the quick recap, can you, for everybody's benefit, can you repeat what are the cancers which are associated with diabetes, and the one particular cancer which has decreased, risk in diabetes?
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Makkar, for the kind introduction, for my beard.
Yes, it is looking better now.
Thank you.
You look more senior.
Yeah,
in fact,
thank
Dr.
You.
Das is looking junior to you now.
Oh, see, Professor Das is ever a young person. So I
just say the joke, appearance is a deceptive bridge.
Sir, so, my appearances are deceptive, but you are still younger than most of us.
Thank you, sir. So at the outset, I thank Professor Das, Professor Alok Kanungo, Dr. Jayant Panda, and whole team of NUCD. Every year I used to attend physically. Of course, this year it is unfortunate to have the virtual conference. Thank you very much for inviting me for this very elegant topic on cancer and diabetes, which I have learned a lot. Even before, I did not know so many things which I have learned from Dr. Sahu, Dr. Sambit Das, and the Dr. Vishwajit. Anyways, what I will quote, just a very important study, and the oncologists which are here, please note this particular study, which is very recently published. And I happen to be the reviewer for this study in Journal of Diabetes, which is recently published from China. And this study is for 400,000 type 2 diabetes patients. Out of these 400,000 patients, 8,500 cancers were found within 3 years of period. And what was the different thing which I have learned from Dr. Sahu and other oncologists just now, that men had lower incidence than the females of the cancer. I don't know the reasons for that. Males were 32% and had the 32% cancers, and females had 64% cases of cancer. However, the men had 11 types of cancers during this 3 years of period, and females had 13 types of cancer. Now, I want to evaluate just a very important study here, that very differently what I have learned here, the men had more of the prostate cancer, leukemia, skin cancers, lymphoma, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, kidney cancers, but they had the least esophageal cancers in type 2 diabetes. Now, another thing, in the females, the 13 types of cases, the most important cases were found in liver cancer. Esophageal cancers were more as compared to thyroid, pancreas, lymphoma, uterine, breast cancers, and cervical cancers. And here, what special things was found is the gallbladder cancer was the least in the females. I don't know the reasons. I have tried to evaluate these type of reasons why these type of cancers are specific to males and females. I don't know, oncologists are here, but this is the study which is has been recently published in Journal of Diabetes. Another study I want to quote Dr. Bridge and for all the panelists here and Dr. Meher, it is Look Ahead. Dr. Rakesh Sahasar, which you have actually quoted, but there is no evidence for the obesity, I mean the hardcore evidence. Look Ahead study was the lifestyle intervention in 4,800 patients, and it was 11-year follow-up of 684 patients with cancers. What the things was found is that in intensive lifestyle intervention, 16% when the weight loss was severe, the 16% lower cancer was found. So that was the relation between Bridge, the diabetes and the cancer. The types of cancers are very specific in type 2 diabetes. However, even the weight loss means obesity is one of the important risk factor for having the diabetes.
I agree
with
you.
That's why the diabetes and cancers are definitely related.
I agree with you that we have, you know, quite a few studies linking obesity and cancer also. And possible mechanism that they are talking of is similar to what is the linking mechanism in diabetes. So I think you presented very interesting data. The earlier discussion and the conventionally what we have known is that prostate cancer is typically lower in diabetes while the other cancers are higher. And Rakesh, you were there in the previous part of this discussion highlighting the same point. But this is very interesting to note that you have least incidence of esophageal cancer in men and the gallbladder cancer in women in diabetes. And it is not the prostate cancer that we saw in men. So would you like to make any comments on this, Rakesh? You are muted.
I think Dr. Arvind Gupta has brought out a very interesting study which he has shown this lower incidence of esophageal cancer in men. But if you look at the meta-analysis, two different meta-analyses are there with about 14 and one with 14 studies and another with about 20 studies looking at the relationship of diabetes with prostate cancer. And they have shown clearly that prostate cancer is lower in men with diabetes as compared to those without diabetes. And the reason that is quoted is that because diabetes and obesity actually increase the production of testosterone. So the low testosterone probably protects them against the development of prostate cancer. That's what has been postulated as the mechanism to explain that lower risk that was seen in people who had diabetes, who had lower risk of prostate cancer.
Hypogonadism is one of the causes that has been, but it is very interesting to note, even if you try to think what could have been the connection between esophageal or gallbladder cancer, is very difficult to
explain,
understand. So my next
Bridge,
part of
Bridge,
the question,
just a
Arvind, just give me
just a minute. Okay. This is a Chinese study.
Okay.
And maybe lifestyle modifications, vegetables, and maybe we don't know some of the carcinogens there for causing the esophageal cancer or gallbladder cancer. We don't know yet, but this is a Chinese study. So maybe it is a lifestyle, it is a diet, which makes a lot of difference between the type of cancers in the Chinese and other populations.
So good you clarified. I thought you said you are going to say it is a Chinese study and we should not trust it. So anyway, so my second part of question to Rakesh is, so now we have, you know, number of studies discussed in previous part of discussion, very interesting study shown by Arvind just now. So what is the linking mechanism between obesity, diabetes, and increased prevalence of cancer?
Yeah, so I think if you look at the coexistence of diabetes, obesity, and these cancers, what we understand is that probably it's the two or three factors that are coming into our mind. Is one is the inflammatory markers which are increased in obesity, in diabetes, so that can actually play an important role. The other aspect is the hyperinsulinemia itself, because of its action at the growth promoting effects of insulin acting through the IGF receptor and several different mechanisms that have been suggested. So all these mechanisms contribute towards this increased risk of cancer among people who are obese and have diabetes.
I think that's very important part. And another factor that has been considered as one of the causative, could be, you know, contributing to increased risk is the increase in these growth factor or binding proteins, yeah, which actually, you know, increase the availability of free forms of certain hormones and IGF, which may be more active in these patients. And second thing is, I think liver and pancreas particularly have been implicated because they are exposed to higher concentrations of insulin all the time. Yeah. So those two mechanisms are also being considered. So with this, I would request my co-moderator, Dr. Dayanidhi Meher, to take the next few questions.
My question to Dr. Rakesh sir is, we have got data from a long registry from different long-term studies and very big registries, but we have found that only few cancers, very specific cancers, are related to diabetes only. But why not all cancers like lymphoma and all those?
Yeah.
Cell carcinoma, we don't have evidence on lung cancers.
Yeah, so I think I think what Dr. Bridgemakar was alluding to just now is very important, that obesity coexisting with diabetes and the fact that hyperinsulinemia is there and the incretin pathways being involved. So all these all the cancers related to these mechanisms are the ones which are increased, and probably you don't have increase in other cancers like lymphomas and leukemias which have other mechanisms playing a role. I think the oncologist in the panel will be able to tell us more about the genesis of those cancers, how they are different from the ones which you are seeing in patients with diabetes. So I think that is probably one of the major reasons why only these cancers are increased, the GI cancers, the colorectal cancers, and all those cancers related to this are increased.
Yeah, and one more thing, in FCPD patients, the risk of pancreatic cancer is 100 times more in comparison to 100 times. Risk is 100 times more.
Absolutely.
But that's not true regarding any other causes of pancreatitis, barring non FCPD pancreatitis.
Yeah. I think that is a very important point.
How can you explain that one?
That's very specific for FCPD. I don't have much insight into this. I think, can we have some comments from Dr. Alok there? Alok, you are there? Dr. Das, would you
comments from Alok later?
Dr. Das, would you like to give some insights on this?
Dr. Arvind Gupta may like to add.
Okay, we can put
no,
this
I
question
don't have anything. Dr. Siddhartho Das, Dr. Ashok Das, Dr. Alok Kanungo, they are the good people.
Yeah, they are, because they are in that area and they have that experience.
Yes. And I think Dr. Meher, why not you?
Please give us some more insights into this.
He is supposed to only ask questions, not answer them.
Okay.
So, you can go on with the next few questions. So, in the meantime, once these people are there, we can, put these questions with them also.
Yeah. And another thing, diabetes and pancreatic cancer, is there a reverse causality? Whether the pancreatic cancer is inducing hyperglycemia or hyperglycemia, it per se is increasing the risk of pancreatic cancer. How to explain the association between the two?
So whatever data, what I understand is the hyperglycemia is associated with increased risk of pancreatic cancer. Leading to diabetes, unless it is there is involvement of the endocrine part, is not there. It is usually exocrine pancreas that is involved in the cancer. But Rakesh would be a better person to comment on this. Rakesh, would you take this?
For some reason, I think, as Mahir has pointed out, that whenever you have pancreatitis along with diabetes, that risk of cancers, definitely pancreatic cancer, goes up tremendously. And I think, as you said, that these are factors which are, the incretins probably play a very important role. And I think that's the reason why we also are very, 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 very sort of wary of using the incretin-based therapies in those.
But Rakesh, now we have so many long CV outcome studies with the incretin therapies. And all these studies, incretin therapies have been used in supraphysiological dose. They are not used in the physiological dose. They have been used in pharmacological dose. And still, we have not seen any increase in the cancers in these patients. So I think that incretin theory is being questioned now.
More of theoretical interest now.
It has not been substituted. Yeah.
So let's switch to some more panelists. So Dr. Biswas is there. So Dr. Biswas, would you like to highlight that whether this increased predisposition for cancer is seen only in type 2 diabetes or it is also in type 1 diabetes patients?
So good evening all. So first of all, thanks to Dr. Alok and Dr. Jains. And thanks for the compliment, Ashok sir. So remember that during 97-98, so I've accompanied him many a times during the exams when he used to be an external. So coming to
Dr. Ghanshyam. Ghanshyam, thank you very much. Thank you very much. I do remember our fond memories. Thank you, sir.
Sir, Dr. Das, please don't go. We have a question for you also.
No, I'm not going anywhere.
So before I come to your question, sir, Makkar sir, so I'll just focus on Dr. Arvind's paper, that Chinese paper. So because cancer has a different predominant in the different parts of the country or even in the cities, like gallbladder cancers, is mostly in the Asian countries and India per se. If you see the eastern part of India and the northern, that is the Himalayan range, so gallbladder is common. So as the esophagus, because in the eastern part, we see more of a stomach cancer and in the western part, we see more of esophageal cancers. So there is a different variance. So that's there. So coming to Dr. Meher, so why diabetes or hyperglycemia not associated with many other cancers? The incidence of lung cancer, so globally in mortality and morbidity is highest because of smoking. So maybe it be smoking or a smokeless. Coming to lymphoma, the incidence of lymphoma going up in last 3 decades is number one because of the rise of HIV infection, the number of transplants and immunosuppressants that we're giving associated with Epstein-Barr virus. And fourth, so many of the gastric lymphomas is associated with H. pylori. So that's the reason of rise of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. So in last 3 decades or so. So coming to your question, sir, so about NIDDM and IDDM, so much has been studied through the NIDDM rather than the IDDM population. And today we see many drugs because the health system is like that. So many patients come to us in an advanced disease and they are not aware of the diabetes. On the first day of diagnosis of cancer, the sugars are 400 plus. So either they had a latent diabetes or they were managing their newly diagnosed diabetes, probably by some conventional method or no tests were done, and at the same time, so the diabetes and the cancer gets rise. So we as an oncologist use steroids like prednisolone, methylprednisolone, and dexamethasone left and right in many cancers today. So like all leukemia, lymphomas, and myeloma protocol have steroids. In pediatric leukemias, lymphomas, L-asparaginase, which can cause pancreatitis, which can cause rise in sugar, is so commonly used. And as Dr. Biswajit says, so there is another new drug, that is a new drug in the breast cancer armamentarium, is alpelisib. So which can cause 70 to 80% rise in blood sugars in most of the patients where insulin may not be the right treatment because they are easily resistant.
Thank you, Dr. Biswas. I think you touched upon quite a few important areas. Dr. Saud, yeah, please.
There is a Swedish trial actually, which is published, and there is an incidence of, again, the same association of type 1 diabetes and some cancers are seen. So it's mainly the same cancers like the endometrium, like the cervical, like the colorectal cancers. So there is a small chunk, but I agree to Ghanshyam bhai. The major chunk of the evidence has come from the type 2 diabetes mellitus.
So basically, if we look at these data, you know, comparing type 2 and type 1 versus the association of cancer, I think it conveys more that more likely that insulin resistance is the connecting mechanism rather than the hyperglycemia. And I think we will have to have more data and more studies, you know, proving or disproving this understanding as of now.
Hyperinsulinemia, apart from obesity and the common risk factors, could be the major thing. That's the only thing that answers partly to Dr. Rakesh's question, why lymphomas and other things which are not associated with obesity, these cancer never associated with obesity. All the cancer which are associated with obesity, so lifestyle modifications are actually having with diabetes.
So, Dr. Das, can we have you on screen?
Please, sir.
Sir, there was a question. There was an important point touched by Dr. Dayanidhi Mehr that the patients with FCPD, they have 100 times higher risk of pancreatic cancer. So, what is the basis for this? Because other pancreatitis is not associated with so much risk.
I think it is a, when you say FCPD, it is a chronic calculi in the pancreatic duct, also in the pancreatic body tail, and also in the pancreatic head. Now, this calcinosis, which occurs all over pancreas, starts in the early childhood and occurs throughout. In the beginning, they present, as Dr. Meher knows, to the gastroenterologist, abdominal pain. Later on, they present to us with type 2 diabetes. So it is believed that this pancreatic duct stones can produce duct obstruction, giving rise to pain and inspiration of the pancreatic secretion, which can be carcinogenic. Plus a constant irritation of the stomach.
I think that is very important.
Yeah.
The irritant is there.
And that's also believed that, you know, they used to have a very famous surgeon in Cuttack called Anand Mishra. I think Alok would remember. Now, we had given him the charge of all the pancreatic stones which produce pain abdomen to take out the stones. We used to say not only relieving of the pain, but also the preventing future cancer was the objective of taking out these stones if they're single and producing obstruction. If they're multiple, nothing much can be done, sir. And one good news is that today the FCPD prevalence, the yearly incidence has come down to rock bottom.
We have a series of more than 200 FCPD patients.
Yes.
But history of cancer is very low.
No, it is rare. I think they will agree with you. It is rare. It is rare. It can occur, but it's rare. But the comparison here between two things, ACP and FCP. ACP starts for alcoholic chronic pancreatitis, and the FCP stands for the fibrocalcic pancreatitis. Between the two, FCP is there's a comparison where the stone is in the tail, stone is in it. In the comparison, it is said that FCP has little prevalence of cancer, which is not there.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for highlighting that. Yeah, Dr. Dayanidhi, can you take questions?
My question to Ghanshyam bhai. Are you listening, bhai?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, there are certain anti-cancer drugs. Those are likely to, particularly this PD-1 inhibitors, they are likely to cause insulitis. So the patients, those who are receiving this PD-1 inhibitors, may likely develop type 1 diabetes.
So these
are there any evidences?
There are checkpoint inhibitors can cause all possible ITs. So starting from eye to the leg. So it can cause keratitis, it can cause pneumonitis, it can cause insulinitis, it can colitis, hepatitis, everything is possible. So checkpoint inhibitors are such drugs. So more than 80% won't have any toxicities. So they will smoothly, just that is how they are different from biologicals and chemotherapy. So certain individuals will develop these toxicities. We don't know which are the patients because we don't have certain biomarkers that this patient is going to have this particular toxicity. So once this patient develops a toxicity, and if they are of grade 3 or grade 4, so these patients cannot be taken for further therapy. So grade 1, 2, so you can hold down, so you can manage. So at times for grade 3, you can stop the drug for some time and we can put them on steroids. And there is always an association that if the patients are on a particular dose of a steroid, so these patients, these checkpoint inhibitors may not work. So that's the association with the drug.
Nidhi, you might remember last time Sanjeevi spoke about this checkpoint inhibitors. Alok would remember checkpoint inhibitors and how they are they produce diabetes. And it was a great lecture by Sanjeevi.
Yes.
I went to Dr. Breeze and to Dr. Arvind Gupta.
Yeah.
We have so many organizations in the country which deal with cancer. And I'm associated with many such. Yeah. One of them in the NCDIR. NCDIR is the burning point, melting point of all cancers in the country. You know, they maintain the registry of the cancer for the Northeast, for the entire country, including Cuttack and everything. So we have suggested to them in the advisory board that the diabetes and cancer is a low-hanging fruit in the sense you can get a great international publication apart from helping mankind. But if you do this study, and I must delight to inform you they have accepted it. So we'll be having some data from the NCDIR, and we'll be involving many of you because it will be a national study. It is a low-hanging fruit. We can complete the research in a year's time of the diabetes and cancer. Ghanshyam, Arvind, Rakesh, Dayanidhi, Bridge, and all the people. Of course, Tarini, and we will involve all of you to get there.
Sure. Thank you.
So I think we are left with the only last few minutes. So before we end this panel discussion, I think one important area is that we know now that diabetes is associated with increased risk of cancer. So Arvind, are you there?
Yeah, I'm there.
Okay. So important question that emerges here is, should we change the screening for cancers recommendation for diabetes patients, or should we screen them as a usual non-diabetes patient, whatever the recommendations are for that? First from Arvind, and then from our oncologist, both the perspective.
From our point of view, it has been already been discussed beautifully by Dr. Sahu and Dr. Vishwajit, that there is no particular clinical markers are there for the screening. And the clinical marker is very clearly, as he told, is the BMI, it is the waist, high waist, and it is the hyperinsulinemia, insulin resistance. So if it is there, this is the definite clinical marker for the cancers. So future cancers and type 2 diabetes. So particularly, like, there is no screening. Dr. Rakesh has already asked Dr. Vishwajit about this thing. There is no particular screening, but clinical markers are definitely there. Now, here I point out
my question. Just to interrupt,
one of the things is that hyperinsulinemia. Yeah,
Arvind, what I mean to ask you is that should we subject diabetes patients to an early screening protocol as compared to a non-diabetic patient for the same cancers using the same markers, or should we screen them as per the standard protocol for general population?
I think we should screen for as per the standard protocol.
Okay. So your quick comments, Rakesh.
Yeah, I think as of now, I mean, although we do see that there is some emerging evidence, we still would recommend as in general population till we have more hard data.
Yeah.
And now, oncologist point of view, Dr. Ghanshyam.
Sir?
Any screening, Dr. Ghanshyam?
Any change in the screening policies?
So we should probably focus on that, because India is a country where we had a good amount of population of diabetes, and definitely cancer is one of those five common causes of death. So this association is getting stronger. So we need to lay down something.
Dr. Sahu, I wanted you to come in. Yes.
Yeah, I slightly differ with Ghanshyam bhai here. And I think the association, it's just an association, there are a lot of gray areas which we are not sure of. And to put a word like screening.
Yeah, it becomes a population-based strategy, you have to think of.
So for me, that is not it. What I take back from this whole meeting of 1 hour is the dietary thing. Are lovely interventions, and those will go a big way. They have been proven in large randomized trials. The paper for breast cancer and the intervention, the diabetic risk diet, which was there, which are presented, that will go a long way. I think in oncology community, that is of interest.
So with this, I think we come to end of this panel discussion and concluding remarks from Dr. Das.
Thank you, Breeze. Thank you very much for a very effective, effective moderating, and thank Dayanidhi, wonderful moderating. Thank you both of you for a great session. I would like to thank Swamya for having chaired the whole meeting. I like to thank Dr. Tarini. Tarini, I was really flabbergasted by your lead talk. And how did you land up in Bhopal? What was the gain to the Silver Line Hospital? Was a loss to us? It was a matter of heart or something. I don't know.
That's a word called destiny. That's what drives all of us.
No, we'll find it. But really liked your talk, and thank you, Tarini. We'll have a long-term association. And I must thank Bishwajit and Rakesh, both my students, for a wonderful interview. Many things you discussed later, aplisimab, all that, which came out in the interview. And dear friends, I must thank again the panelists, Rakesh, Dr. Ghanshyam. I do remember your association, great association, Ghanshyam. And Dr. Senapati could not be here. Arbin, and for this wonderful session. Dear friends, a very sincere thanks to all of you. We wanted to do something different, something new, and you have made it. It is 1.5 hour discussion, Tarini, and we have covered some grounds which we rarely cover. And with this, we have finished the fourth session. We're left with two. Both are very important. One on the complications, other on insulin. May I hand over the session to Dr. Alok to kindly take it forward. Thank you very much, all of you.
Thank you, sir.
Breeze. And I don't know how to thank Breeze, Rakesh, Arvind, Tarini, and Dayanidhi, and Ghanshyam, and Bishwajit, and every one of you made it conference great. Thank you.